Welcome to Iron Rhetoric with your intrepid host, Pastor Brett McAtee. Truth forever on the scaffold, wrong forever on the throne. Yet that scaffold sways the future, and behind the dim unknown, standeth God within the shadow, keeping watch above his own.
Today's scripture reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 through 7. And if you are using the Pew Bible, it is on 1471. Here are the words of the Lord. This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not covetous, one who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Let us pray. O Holy Father, Lord, our Creator Jehovah, Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, Redeemer, and by the works of the Holy Spirit, prepare our hearts to receive your message as your servant, Pastor Brett, speaks your word. Lord Jesus Christ, be praised. Amen.
Amen. So We continue through our march through Timothy, and here we continue to take up the issue of the qualifications for men who desire to be elders. We began on that last week. We looked particularly at the idea of the family dynamics that come into play here. We considered the idea that he has to be the husband of one wife. We looked at what that meant. We considered the idea of the importance of having his family in order, his children being respectful, ruling well in his own house. And as we continue to break down what's looked for in an elder, we want to note some of the background that will help us to understand the reasons the Holy Spirit here emphasizes that which he emphasizes. Keep in mind the context here. Paul has said that women are not to have authority over men. And it's as if he's saying now, not only are women not to have authority over men, but it's not just any man that can have this position of authority, of ruling. And so it's as if he says to the whole congregation, look, it's not just that women are not to have authority, but only very precise and particular kind of men are to have authority. And then he gives a list of the kind of men that are to have authority in the church. And we find this to be incredibly important. We should have a comprehension, all of us in the pew should have a comprehension of this, because it's probably going to be the case at one time or another, we're going to be choosing who it is that we want to have to rule over us. We're going to be voting for elders. And so we should have an idea of what to look for. And Paul here, also in the pastoral epistles in the book of Titus, he gives another similar list. But Paul here gives what he's looking for in an elder. As we consider the background, we understand that Scripture does not come to us in a cultural vacuum. This church in Ephesus, where Timothy's at, was located in a particular time and a particular place. And the necessity to write what Paul has written here would have been contextual to what Timothy was dealing with as he's dealing with the situation in Ephesus. And when we deal with this letter, that is 1 Timothy, we must always keep in mind the problem that we looked at several weeks ago of false teachers. It's very likely here that due to their perverse behavior, that is the perverse behavior of the false teachers, which was an inversion of what Paul calls for here, that is the impetus behind what Paul is doing here when he gives these qualifications. In other words, you have to understand, as we've said before, these false teachers, yes, Paul's labeling them as false teachers, but in terms of the city of Ephesus, they're trying to sell themselves as being the elders or the representatives of what? The church. The church there in Ephesus. And these chaps are not only false teachers, but as we said, they've embraced a religion, an ideology called Gnosticism. And it's a big subject upon which whole books are written. It was the first serious heresy in the church. But for our purposes today, this Gnosticism, as I've mentioned before, either believed that the body was evil and so had to be squelched, and so you would starve yourself and you would roll around in thorns and you'd all do all kinds of things to deny the evil body, or the body was meaningless. It was unimportant, right? Because what was really important was the spirit within you. And if you believe the body was meaningless, that meant that you might be sexually perverse. And so that's why Paul can say that an elder needs to be what? The husband of one wife. So you can see how perhaps he's looking at these false teachers, their Gnosticism, and he's saying, don't be like that, right? The same issue would be with the idea, and we're going to look at these more particularly, but with the idea of drunkenness, right? Well, who cares what you do to the body? You know, the body's unimportant. So, you know, intoxicate yourself, get involved in drunken orgies. You know, this would have been the mindset of these Gnostic false teachers, and Paul says no. Later he's going to talk about these men that are to be rulers of God's house are not to be drunkards. So all of what's being said here comes in a cultural context, and it's very likely the case, we don't know 100%, but it's very likely the case that this list that Paul gives is a list that's given because of the dynamics of what he's resisting in the false teachers that he speaks about in chapter 1. So as such, this list becomes a rebuke to the false teachers who were mentioned earlier, and there was a need for the kind of man the Holy Spirit calls for in order to clear the good name of the church in Ephesus. A name that needed to be cleared because, as we said, the false teachers themselves claimed to be the representatives of the name of church and in the name of Christ. It's interesting, if we pause here a second, though, we might add to see how the first century is being reincarnated in 2024. We are once again at the point where meaning is becoming completely subjective, and that's what was going on with these Gnostics. Just as the Gnostics tied no meaning to the excesses done in the body, we as a culture today have given up on objective meaning. Meaning, that is to say, that is outside of our own determination. We today, like the first century Ephesus, are just as given over to excesses that arise from a culture of meaninglessness. And I don't need to spend a great deal of time belaboring that point, do I? I don't need to spend a great deal of time saying, you know, here's the first century and their excesses, and here we are in 2024, and look at the similarities between the two. And it's because there's been an abandonment of biblical Christianity. When you abandon biblical Christianity, what fills in the vacuum is meaninglessness, whether driven by Gnosticism or driven by the subjectivity that man is his own center. It doesn't matter. The kind of things that you're seeing going on in Ephesus will go on in every culture that abandons Christ. And Paul says one of the stopgaps, one of the things that the church needs to be is salt and light, and what it needs to have to be the best salt and light it can be is leaders that look like something. And remember, we said last week that these chaps that are going to be entering into these positions, understand it isn't like today. You know, today you take the position of deacon or elder, and well, it's typically not at a great cost, but here in the first century, if you're going to be a deacon or an elder in the church, you likely were going to be very much targeted. You were going to be hated, because Christians were not typically well-liked in this particular culture. So Paul is concerned here about the witness of the church, and so he wants to protect it by putting noble men of high caliber into the role of overseer or elder or bishop. And by the way, all those three words, overseer, bishop, elder, they're all synonymous. And the need for these kind of men remain today. We continue to have a need for holy men who serve as under-shepherds of the flock of Christ. And in this passage before us this morning, we get some idea of what kind of nobility that we're to find in the overseer of God's flock. One more thing by way of background before we get into this list of things that are listed here. One more thing that we want to background and want to note here by way of background is, interestingly enough, is that all the virtues expected of the bishop here are elsewhere in Scripture expected of all God's people. So when we look at this list, we're mindful that this is something that we're all called to one degree or another. It seems then that this list is a matter of choosing men who will lead by exemplifying what all God's people are called to. So as we read this list and as we look at it, it's true that we should be thinking of this in terms of men who are going to lead us as elders, but it's also an aspect where we have to look at this as saying, what does this say about me? Am I moving in this direction when it comes to this list? We'll be working through these, but to give just a few examples of how what's required here for elders elsewhere in Scripture is required for all people, and so we're all to be concerned with these things. I'll give just a few examples. For example, the overseer is to be self-controlled. That's one of the things that's listed here. Yet, as you know probably, self-control is listed as one of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians. And that is to be characteristic of all citizens of God's kingdom. The same is true of being gentle. The overseer here is not to be quarrelsome, but to be gentle. And yet, being gentle is likewise something that's required of all God's people. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Another example we might put on the burner here is the disallowance of drunkenness for elders. But elsewhere we read that believers as a whole are not to be drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, we are to be filled with the Spirit. So even though we're told here that elders are not to be a drunken lot, it's not the case that we can say, well, guzzle, 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 guzzles. That's only for the elders. I can drink as much as I want. Another example, and again, I could repeat this over and over again. I'm just trying to show you that this list here, although it's perhaps to be exemplified in the elders, is something that's called for upon God's people, is this issue of hospitality. Elders are to be hospitable. And again, we're going to be circling back and looking at these. I'm just trying to make a point here. In Hebrews 13, the believers are told, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. And so the reason I want to emphasize the idea that there's overlap between what's expected of the elder and what's expected in our own lives, perhaps the degree is differing, but the reason I want to get at this at the outset is I want us to see that this is something that to one degree or another is laid upon all of us, this list that we're looking at. So yes, we are looking for this in an exemplified manner in the men that are going to be ruling to a higher degree or a higher pitch perhaps. But these traits are to be characteristic of all Christians. One more example, why not? This idea of even this aptness to teach, again, which we'll cover in more depth in a bit, while perhaps unique to the overseer in relation to their calling, is something that Paul will require also in the pastoral epistles of the elder women. He'll tell the elder women, he says to them, take the younger women and do what? Teach them. Right? Now, it may have been teaching them different things, how to keep a home and that kind of thing, but still, there is that responsibility. D.A. Carson, a theologian today, chimes in here. The writer of the Hebrews wants his readers to know, writes to his readers, he's upset by how little they know, and he says in the long warning of chapter 5 and 6, by this time you ought to be teachers. He doesn't mean they all ought to be pastors. It means that they're still slow and thick and not absorbing the word of God and not able to pass it on to others. In one sense, then, we're all supposed to be teachers, even if there's a restriction on that at one level or another. So the upshot of this truth is that we should not look for in elders what we do not desire to see in ourselves. Also, an implication here, as I've already hinted at, is that we can't excuse ourselves in not advancing in sanctification in these various issues or virtues by saying, hey, I can be a lover of money. I could be a lover of money if I want. After all, I'm not an overseer, and I don't desire to be one, so I can go ahead and love all the money I want. And by the way, lover of money is one of these things, not being a lover of money. And such, even though this list is pointed as particularly at elders, these virtues should be virtues all of us as God's people should be aiming at. It should be the expectation, as I taught the children, that the Holy Spirit is indwelling in us. If, as Paul says, we've been given the Holy Spirit as a deposit which is to come, one of the things the Holy Spirit is doing is he's sanctifying us. He's conforming us to Christ's image. And in this list, we find some of those things that are conforming issues for all of us, but especially, again, obviously for elders. As we jump into this list, we know what's not listed here. It's not listed that the overseer has to have 140 IQ. Paul is not requiring the overseer to be alpha males, to have a salesman shining and winning personality. Although, to be honest, that helps. There's no requirement that they've attended a premier university or seminary, although that could possibly help in the apt-to-teach category. It also could possibly injure it. Most of the virtues listed here are matters of character. Many of them have to do with how elders are to interact with those they are shepherding or overseeing. And so are instrumental when it comes to the behavior found in pastoring as the overseer interacts with whom they are seeking to pastor. I mean, think about it. This requirement to be gentle. That's relational, right? That's a relational kind of idea. And we find many of these kinds of relational aspects in this list. With that said, we consider these virtues that is to be found in one degree or another in all elders. However, keep in mind, congregation, as Calvin notes, that some men will be stronger in some areas and others will be weaker in others. You're not going to find somebody who's going to be walking on water in all of these areas. Men are going to have strengths and they're going to have weaknesses. This is Captain Obvious stuff, I know. As we said last week, above reproach here does not mean perfect. Indeed, the word conveys the idea that elders should be men against whom no charge of immorality or holding false doctrine is alleged. When they say above reproach, I think the idea is that they are not scandalous. And scandal so often falls upon the church, right? It happened just this past week, a scandal came out. Somebody that was of a clergy of a particularly high station had a fall and everybody's gasping. It happens. We're saddened for the church, we're saddened for him, but it happens. So the idea here is above reproach, his conduct should be irreprehensible or irreproachable. Undoubtedly, it means that if any charge could be brought against him implying moral obliquity, I like that word, obliquity, he's not fit for the office. He should be a man of irreproachable character for truth, honesty, chastity, and general uprightness. You know, for example, while I was in the ministry, I also worked at United Airlines. And if the people at United Airlines, you know, if I was scandalous, they would, and they knew I was a minister, that would look bad on what? The whole church, right? We'll get at that more later when he talks about having a good reputation with those outside the church. But the idea here is that no stain is going to be found to be cast upon the church in Christ because he's above reproach. Calvin put it this way in his commentary. He's not to be marked by any infamy that would lessen his authority. There'll be no one found among men that is free from every vice. But it's one thing to be blemished with ordinary vices, which do not hurt their reputation, because they are found in men of the highest excellence. And another thing to have a disgraceful name or to be stained with any baseness. So above reproach does not mean the guy walks on. If you're waiting for somebody to walk on water, you're never going to have an elder. Right? Of course, if the overseer is stained with any baseness, that stain of baseness will end up being a blemish on the church. This is what Paul is trying to avoid, because that's what's going on here in Ephesus with these false teachers. They're bringing stains in the churches. We should note here, as we set out this list, if you live just a little life, you can probably come up with more than a few examples of how this stain of baseness because of fallen overseers has indeed stained the church. I've been around the church now all my life, actually, and I've seen it, unfortunately, too many times. Paul doesn't mention it here, but when this baseness enters in with the overseer, you can probably well imagine what will sometimes happen within the church when stain is found to be on the overseer. The church will what? Will split. It'll be those that'll run to the chap and they'll say, "Oh no, he's misunderstood." And there'll be others that say, "No, no." And before you know it, there's a split in the church. For this is this is another angle here as well. We might know, as we set out to look at this list, that often it's the case that many congregations do not want these kind of men serving them who fulfill this list and who are indeed above reproach. Many congregations don't want this because such a man is a standing indictment against such a congregation's desire to be left alone in the fact that they are comfortable themselves in not being above reproach. An overseer that is not above reproach provides license for the whole congregation to not be above reproach. And so congregations often will look for somebody who has some reproach, because then it says to them, he's not going to stand and speak against, my sin. So it becomes a very cozy relationship between the pastor, the overseer, the elder, and the congregation. So this idea of above reproach serves as an umbrella term then, and above reproach applies to these 11 different areas that are going to be listed. Some positively are listed, be this, be gentle. Some are listed negatively, not quarrelsome. This above reproaches will be required in this letter to the congregation as a whole, though. If you look at chapter 5 in the same book, verse 7, there we read, "And these things command that they may be blameless." He's talking to the whole congregation. He's saying to Timothy, "These things command that they may," who's the they? The congregation, "may be" what? Blameless. Same word, above reproach. So once again, we see what's required for the elder is at least theoretically supposed to be true of the whole congregation. At least that's the mark. In the area of being temperate, that's now we're looking at this list. We're not talking about the husband of one wife. Why? You already know the answer to that because we looked at it last week. So we'll go on to temperate. The idea of being temperate, being above reproach in that category. The idea contained here is not as might be normally thought of in relation to alcohol. Remember, in your history, perhaps you remember that once upon a time in the early 1900s, late 1800s, there was a thing called the Blank Society. You remember? Temperance Society, Carry Nation and all that, right? And so temperance was often associated with, and is still with this word, it's so associated with alcohol. However, because Paul talks about drunkenness later, it's probably the word temperate here is not being used to refer to alcohol here. Usually what's being gotten at with the idea of temperate is that the overseer, the elder, is to be a man in control of their passion. He doesn't fly off the handle. right? He's not rash. He's free from extremes and excesses. I like the synonym here. I've determined I'd someday like to preach on just this one word. He's a man who is stable. I think stability is something that you find all the way through scriptures and being required for Christians and for leaders. The temperate person then is the person who is well-balanced, calm, steady. He doesn't let his emotions control him, but he controls his emotions. Something very closely to that idea of temperate is found soon, but we would say that an overseer is going to need this ability to be temperate because overseeing provides many opportunities for one to lose their mind, to not be even keeled. As an elder, as an overseer, you see things, experience things that make you go, what? What am I seeing here? And yet, in light of that, you have to be temperate, controlled, not given to excesses. Indeed, the word, next word off that is used here is similar to that, sober-minded, or in some of your translations is the idea of self-controlled. As we said, this is somewhat implied in the word temperate, but here the emphasis seems to be upon what we call prudence or thoughtfulness. Together, the words temperate and self-controlled paint the picture of a man who's not going to be blown about by difficult circumstances. He is the one who seeks to be very measured in his consideration of matters and thoughtful regarding the conclusions he arrives at. He is a rock. He is not a man who can be stampeded by the difficulty of the situation or the emotion of the moment. Now, you can understand cultures that are in turmoil, like here in Ephesus and like what we're living in today, they don't typically produce men who are, or people who are temperate and sober-minded or self-controlled. They just don't produce those kind of men. Because the culture itself is in a constant upheaval. And so it creates people who are in a constant upheaval. And yet Christians are supposed to be those who are swimming against the current, especially the leaders. They're to be temperate, self-controlled, sober-minded. Remember, we're saying self-controlled, sober-minded, largely synonymous here. He goes on, he talks about being respectable. Some of your translations say good behavior, and the translations will vary on these particular words because there's different shades of meaning going on here. Respectable really means somebody who can be respected. The word denotes the idea of orderliness. Perhaps that's why one of the favorite sayings of Presbyterian is that everything must be done decent and in order, right? So, the elder that you're looking for has to be respectable. There's an orderliness, an inward moral excellency that shows itself in its outward appearance. For example, one would expect to find one's overseer or elder or pastor acting like an initiate at a frat party at a university. He's not the guy who has the road cone in his mouth where they're pouring a pitcher of beer in, right? Because that would not be respectable. If we wanted to go back to the 70s, if I was preaching, he's not the guy who's going to be streaking. Some of you might remember what that was, right? A chap I read on a commentary from the 19th century, it was amazing given his cultural environment, because what he wrote is that basically an overseer has to be a Victorian gentleman. He has to have the highest manners, was what he said. And there's probably some truth in that. Now, I want to get away from the idea that what we're listing is somebody who's an old, boring fogey. But you can see why these character traits are so important in a church that's in a context where the culture is swirling the drain. Paul says, these are the kind of men that you want. And remember, he's writing to a congregation, not of a bunch of highbrows. He's writing to a congregation that was going to be largely of peasants, we would say today. And yet, this is what the character he's looking for. This is the character that God is requiring. Also, he is to be hospitable. This is a word that's used here. The ancient world was a hard place. They might have had the things similar to what we call hotels today. They wouldn't have been anything like the Best Western off of every exit. But whatever they had, they were often the case that they were just miniature brothels. You could have any woman you wanted along with the room you paid for, as well as a boy if you wanted one. They were places where could be easily robbed. If a messenger had to go from church A to church B and was going to be on the road, he was going to need hospitality. And so what was required of the elder to be hospitable? He had an open door. I think of my own in-laws, my father-in-law and mother-in-law. Always an open door. People always dropping in. When people dropped in, guess what was almost instantly on the table? Somewhere, my mother-in-law would find food, and there it is on the table. Hospitable. There were in the ancient world, as I said, no Best Westerns off of every exit. Welfare programs and safety nets didn't exist in the least. Bandits were everywhere on the main roads. Hospitality to fellow Christians would be a hallmark of the overseer. Here, though, again, we find a virtue that is being required of the elder in extremis, but also required of God's people. In Hebrews 13:2, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels unaware. Romans 12:13, share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. 1 Peter 4:9, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And so as you consider elders, you consider people that have an open door policy. It's a real gift welcoming people and making them feel comfortable in your home. Some people have opened homes, but yet they don't really have the knack of making you feel comfortable once you're in their home. This is what the idea of hospitable is. The elder is to be above reproach when it comes to this practice. Elsewhere, he says, next, elders are apt to teach. They have an ability to teach. Of course, being able to teach assumes something here. It assumes that one knows the doctrine that needs to be taught. So here is something that is to be especially true of the overseer. Still, it's the case that we're all required to be ready to give an answer to all who ask for the hope that lies within us. And when we give that answer, we are at that point then, teaching. And so teaching requires this idea, not only the ability to communicate, but it also assumes that you have a content that you can communicate. This apt to teach then is a challenge for all of us in the Christian West. We are in entertainment culture. We're in an entertainment culture that mitigates strongly against this ability to teach requirement. Why? Because the entertainment culture says, amuse, amuse, amuse. And you know what amuse? Do you know what amuse literally means? The ah is a negation, and the muse means think. So to amuse yourself is to not think. Well, that's the kind of culture we live in. You can use amusement, you can use entertainment. It communicates the same idea. So everything is pushing you not to think. And people who don't think are not people who are apt to teach. And so this one is really pushed. The ability to have this is really pushed against in cultures that are draining down to the bottom. I think of Neil Postman's book, which I highly recommend. It's called Amusing Ourselves to Death. Right? Everything in this culture, When you go to school, you think school is educating, but it's not. School's purpose is to dumb you down, to not give you the ability to think, and so not have the ability to teach. When you go to the films or you look at the TV, you're in a passive mode, and it's coming at you, and you're not engaging it. And so your thought abilities are going down, and you're just receiving, and so you don't have the ability to think, and so you're not going to have the ability to teach. People don't read newspapers very much anymore, but our newspapers were written at a fourth grade level. So this aptness to teach is a tough road in this particular culture, but there it is. Elders are to be those who are apt to teach. And they can't be those who are apt to teach unless they are those who throw themselves all their lives into their learning. The price paid to be an overseer is the time that is required in order to be able to be one who is genuinely apt to teach. This is something that is especially required of the elders. And to be honest, all because you have people filling pulpits, standing in pulpits, it doesn't mean they have the ability to teach. It could mean that, and I think this is, and I get in trouble saying these kind of things, but I'll say it anyway. It could be that they're just an empty suit. Indeed, I would say most pastors are empty suits. This is something you have to realize as a congregation years later, years down the road. Some of you are very young. You have to understand that your pastor has the responsibility of being a learner. He cannot be apt to teach if he's not somebody who's apt to learn. This is why movers hate when they hear they have to go in and move a pastor. Why do they hate it? Because the books, all right? Would that more books were read by more pastors. All right, I think I've beaten that one enough. But I do think that this is central to what an elder, is, an overseer, is called to do. From here we go to the requirements that are negatively stated. You know, you're apt to teach, you're hospitable. These are all positive statements. But now there are some negatives, put negatively, I would say. The first one is, we've already touched on, some elders are not to be given to drunkenness. They're not to be violent. They're not to be quarrelsome. These words are strung together, I believe, because there's a logic to it. Drunkenness, as you know, tends to make many men mean. You ever heard that phrase? He's a blank drunk. He's a mean drunk, right? So Paul might have strung these words together because they implied one another. Mean drunks are then, of course, violent. They're quarrelsome. It's interesting, the Greek philosopher Seneca said a short little Latin phrase. I'm going to give you the English. Wine kindles wrath. Now, not every drunk is a mean drunk, but many of them are. So some of you, I suspect, have known mean drunks. The first century was characterized, as we said earlier, by a lot of flowing intoxicants. This is not surprising, since one sign of a culture in decline, one sign of a culture that has lost its grip on meaning that we talked about earlier, is to self-medicate in order to make the pain of meaninglessness and cultural breakdown manageable. Even for Christians, and I was talking to a chap yesterday who confessed this, there can be a temptation to self-medicate as there is a hard time coping with the breakdown of civilization. And so the Holy Spirit here says the elder is to be above reproach when it comes to drunkenness, violence, and being quarrelsome. You don't want somebody in the pulpit or as an overseer that gives his wife a backhand, or his children treats, or perhaps will grab his children, his son by the neck and do this, which I've seen before. This idea of being quarrelsome is the idea of somebody who's always has a chip on their shoulder, right? The person with the chip on their shoulder is doing what? I dare you to knock it off. Because if you knock it off, we're going to rumble. Instead, overseers to be gentle. And I want to say here, that's not the same as being a doormat. There's a temptation for the elders to lose their temper with people and possibly become violent with their words instead of they are to be gentle. At least that should be their prayer. They go on to say here, not a lover of money. As you understand, overseers are going to be around church funds. There have been more than a few examples of pastors caught with their hands, as the phrase goes, in the till. If they're lovers of money, they are apt to take the money and run. Or if they're lovers of money, they might, over the course of time, become embittered because they don't have money. And so what Paul is saying here is we need to beware to becoming like Judas who owned the purse strings and who sought to enrich himself by dishonest means. But of course, you know that Scripture lays upon all of us that we're not to be lovers of money. You cannot serve both God and mammon or money. So what you're looking for in an elder is what you're looking for in yourself, only as it's been nourished and nurtured over time. I guess I should pause here and just ask, do you want those kind of elders? Do you want those kind of overseers? More than that, in your own local church, do you want to see those kind of men proliferate in the church? We covered 4 and 5 last week, so we're not going to go back over that territory today, so we polish this off by 6 and 7. We're getting near the end of our time together. He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. And I have to tell you, this was the one I had the hardest time with. Because I do understand how a recent convert can become conceited, but I don't understand how anybody in the ministry for any length of time could become conceited. I mean, I know it happens. I'm not denying it. I'm just saying, I mean, I've been around this all my life. The clergy corps, the overseers. And what I've seen over my life, I'll start with my father-in-law, who was the best pastor you could imagine in terms of shepherding and caring for people. The man was beaten down over and over again. Our own Sam Perry was treated like a rabid dog might treat hamburger if he had the opportunity. I mean, how could Sam ever become conceited in light of the way he was treated? I know Sasha Wallacourt on the west side of the state. I know of Michael Spangler, another clergy. These are all clergy. And they've been treated so badly, I wonder how the warning could ever exist to not be conceited. But yet, there it is. You get what I'm saying, right? How could anybody beat up ever become conceited? But yet, Paul understands that a newbie, he gets into the position. Maybe he's got some talent and skills. People are praising him. He begins to believe his own press clippings. He thinks, yeah, I am a pretty guy. Maybe he's got some groupies that are always around him telling, You know, he's got all that going on, and he begins to get conceited. What's another word for conceited? Pride. You know, he gets, head begins to swell. And because of that, he thinks he can make eyes at the pretty young females and there won't be any consequences. Next thing you know, he's fallen under the judgment of the devil. The judgment of the devil here is a reference to the fact that the devil is understood that he fell because of what issue? Pride. So conceit, falling under the judgment of the devil, you get pride, and eventually no man should think he stands lest he what? Lest he fall. So I think that's what's going on here in this whole idea of not being a recent convert. And there's temptations to put recent converts into these positions. Let's say you have a small church like ours, and you have somebody you think is a solid person, he's a recent convert, and you need a warm body because you have what? You have a position to fill. And so just because he's a warm body and you think he's got a good trajectory, you stick him in there and you've done damage to him, and you've probably done damage to the church. Believe me, I've been guilty of that. That is, putting people in positions that they probably weren't ready to put in. So Paul says, not a recent convert. In verse 7, he says, he must also have a good reputation with those who are on the outside so that he will not fall into the disgrace, into the devil's trap. The devil's trap likely refers to the trap set by the devil to bring the faith into disrepute. The good reputation has to be under, with those outside, has to be understood. This is something that we have to, Jesus says, if they hated me, they'll hate you also. Right? The scripture also says, friendship with the world is enmity with God. And so this whole idea of a good reputation with those on the outside, we have to be careful that we don't, I mean, clergy who stand on God's word are going to be hated by the outside precisely because they're standing on God's word. So I think what's being aimed at here, and we're closing down, I know I've been at this a while, the thing that's being aimed at here, I think, is the idea that there cannot, it's back to above reproach, that there cannot be anything that's scandalous, that's true, that's thrown on him that sticks. Right? He can't be discovered to be found out while having an international ministry that he bought a chain of massage parlors and then found out to be taking some of the fruit of those massage parlors. And I use that because that's happened to a very well-known evangelist. I don't know how long it's been, 10, 15 years ago, whatever it's been. And so I think it's scandalous stuff that's being spoken about when it comes to good reputation with those on the outside. But we cannot make that walk on all fours to suggest that he is a hail and well met by all parties person. Does that make sense, that qualification? I hope so. So having said all of this, and here we're now closing, you can understand why it's so intimidating to be an overseer. All of these qualifications make the elder to be thankful again for the righteousness of Jesus Christ being placed to his account. Because if we measure these in absolute terms, none of us are qualified to be an overseer. But instead, what we need to understand is that this is being measured by a general tenor and a directional aspect that this person is moving towards. I mean, you don't want the case where you have guys in the pulpit who are so good you don't ever want to see them leave, but when they get out, they're so bad you never want to see them get back in. And so this is what's expected of elders. And as I said, Paul gives us list. Also in Titus, Peter makes reference to the requirements of an under-shepherd. And in closing, we'd say, honestly, a passage like this reminds all of us, since we're all called to these virtues, of the absolute necessity to be robed in the favor of Christ. Yes, we long to measure up to these qualifications, but we see here where we've missed the mark. This is a hard sermon to study for and a hard sermon to preach, because I realize that I haven't met the absolute standard on these things as an overseer. But you know what? I'm thankful that I see that. I'd hate to have preached this passage and said, yep, that's me. Yep. Boy, aren't these people lucky they have me. Right? So I'm glad that this has been a burden on studying and in preaching, because it reminds me that my only hope, our only hope, is found in Christ. And it also makes me pray, mercy, Lord, followed by praying, grant me thy spirit that I may increasingly walk in all these ways. Let's stand for a closing word of prayer. And now, Father, we pray that our desire would be that we would all clothe ourselves with these character qualities that are to be found in all Christians, but most especially in elders. We pray, Father, that for this church, you would raise up these kinds of men. We thank you, Father, for Sam, who is this kind of man. We thank you, Father, for the elders in the past that we've had that are these kinds of men. Thank you for Mike and how he has walked in these terms. And so, Father, we pray that you might give more elders to this church, but not only this church, but the Reformed Church. We think especially of pastors that, once again, as they stand in the pulpit, they will be apt to teach and not just regurgitating what the culture is serving up with a patina of Christianity, covering it. We pray that they might be thorough thinkers, thinking through their faith and be able to articulate it to your people. Oh, Father, we desperately need a time where, once again, there are these kind of elders, overseers. I pray for your people here, especially those who are younger, that they might live to see a time where these kind of overseers are not as sparse as they are now. In Christ's name, we pray.
Thank you for joining us today. Look for us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and YouTube Music. Be sure to give us a 5-star review, like, and share.